Goed, hè? Ja, af en toe. Hello and welcome to Reykjavik Grapevine's newscast. My name is Valur Grettisson and I'm an editor-in-chief at Reykjavik Grapevine. You will be able to find my name in the description if you want to know how it is spelled. We're here in Heiðmörk. There is no good reason that we're here, actually. Art just wanted to show you the incredible fields of lupin in Iceland. This is Alaska lupins, and they are like, they have been controversial throughout the years. They came here as immigrants in the 1900s. The main reason that we are fighting about them is because they are very effective to combining the soil, like to make it more steady so the sand won't be like blowing everywhere. It's a foreigner. That's why Icelanders are against it, I guess. But it also, it suffocates in many ways. They can suffocate other flowers. But to be honest, if I had to pick between the beautiful purple lupins or the black sands, I'm actually more of a fan of the flowers. This over there is of course Reykjavik, but not only Reykjavik. You can now actually see both Garðabær, Kópavogur, and then Reykjavik in the end. So these are like three towns you're actually looking over right now. Shows you perhaps how small Iceland is. Hey. It's so small, so you have to jump through these fields. Hafnarfjörður, the most beautiful town in the world, in my opinion, of course, is over there. We're going to show you the Hafnarfjörður, you will see it a little bit better as we go on. Just before we start, remember our sponsor, of course, Einstök, Einstök Beer. They even opened a bar, actually, downtown. I went there over the weekend. I'm a little bit tired of the weekend because we have no restriction domestically at all. So we actually can go and we can dance and just have fun as we want to. And if you don't want to dance, you can just go to a coffee house without a mask. Also, remember our High Five Club. It really helps us out. And subscribe and like if you like it, of course, and share it if you really want to. Let's go for the news, because we have international news. We have a lot of interesting things going on. First this. First news, and this is incredibly interesting. Stundin is a small news magazine in Iceland. It's incredibly good. When it comes to investigative journalism, for example, last 5 or 6 years, RÚV, which is our national broadcast, have had seven of these awards in Icelandic media, and Stundin has 5 of them. They are by far the best when it comes to investigating journalism. So, Stundin broke this incredible news this weekend about a man called Sigurður Þórðarson, or Siggi the Hacker. Siggi the Hacker became, I think, world news like in 2011, 12 or 13. After he used to be a volunteer in Julian Assange's WikiLeaks. He was only, I think, 17 or 18 years old when he started out. He was in this very controversial interview with BBC. And he was only called Siggi the Hacker. And there he was claiming that he had been a hacker since he was like a kid, like 11, 12 years old. He said that he hacked the government official websites and such. In short, none of this was true, actually. Siggi is not much of a hacker, but he is like a data thief, if you will. So he was a perfect fit, I guess, for association like WikiLeaks, but not entirely, because he never gave WikiLeaks any information or anything. But he was famous and well-known in Iceland because he was actually outed as one of the sources when it came to leaking very sensitive documents that got the chairman of the Independence Party into trouble and so on. And these were serious information. And the DV, which is also a newspaper in Iceland, they did a lot of good things with the information, but it doesn't really matter here. What matters here is that in 2011 or 12, he actually became a witness for FBI in the case against Julian Assange. And Julian Assange, I mean, I don't know if I need to actually tell you anything about the man. He's of course very well known, but Iceland has a very special relationship with WikiLeaks as well as Julian Assange. Icelanders were very much in WikiLeaks at the time, in the beginning. And you know how this story is. It's very controversial. It blew up, of course, in the end, and Assange ended up going into the Ecuadorian embassy because of a lot of allegations, both, of course, mostly because of these sexual misconduct in Sweden, which is, as I understand it, not anymore the case. So he's in UK, been more or less in jail first, of course, like self-imprisoned in this Ecuadorian embassy. And the last year or two, I think, he has, of course, been in custody. And the US officials, AKA FBI, they want him extradited to the US. Now, here comes Siggi Hakkarinn. He actually is a huge part of this indictment when it comes to the extradition. The reason is that in this indictment, there is a mention of this teenager as well as NATO country number one. Simple enough, NATO country number one is, of course, Iceland. And this teenager, which is now a 28-year-old man, is, of course, not a teenager, but Siggi Hakkari or Sigurður Þórðarson. I think it's easier if you Google him, Siggi the Hacker. You can find interviews with him in, for example, the Rolling Stones and a lot of big news outlets. The thing is that what he is saying, and FBI is saying that he broke the law, is that Siggi actually contacted very dangerous hackers all around the world. At the time, this was Lulzsec, and this was like Sabu, which was a New York-based hacker, and he ended up actually working with the FBI in the end in exchange for his freedom, more or less. This is a very exciting story, of course, and quite interesting. Now, and here's what Stundin comes in. Bjartmar Alexandersson, you know him very well. He's a friend of mine, and he did this. He does this Icelandic perspective with us. But he is, of course, like I said in the first episode of the Icelandic perspective, an investigative journalist. Mostly, he's writing about environmental issues, but sometimes he does something else, and this is something else. So he met up with Siggi the Hacker, and he interviewed him for 9 hours about all of these allegations and about his history when it came to WikiLeaks. And what he found out was that Siggi is, well, first of all, a convicted, he has been convicted many times, often for fraud, but also for sexually assaulting teenage boys. There were eight or nine victims. He got not that high of a prison time. He himself was very young when this happened, and the boys were a few years younger. So he was older than 18. I think he was 18 or 19 when this happened, but the boys were from 15 to 17 or something like that. So he has since then. Siggi has been convicted for a lot of crimes, mostly when it comes to money and embezzlement and such. We can find this, of course, all in this article at Stundin that I will link down there. But what was perhaps most interesting here is that Siggi, which has actually been documented by a court-appointed psychiatrist as a borderline sociopathic individual. He has received several convictions, of course, for sexually abusing minors. And he has been received promise of immunity from persecution from American laws if he actually is a witness against Julian Assange. And he claims that Julian Assange asked him to contact these individuals, these hackers, to attack the infrastructure of Iceland. And when I'm talking about infrastructure, I'm talking about Landsnet, which is, hello. Eru Íslandingar eða? Já, við takum við að reykja að greipa þeim bara.
Já,
dásamlegt. A lot of people here, of course, this is a lovely place. So, what he did is that he says that Assange gave him a direct order that asked him to attack Icelandic infrastructure, and in this was Landsnet, which is our like electricity infrastructure. It's a state-owned company, one of the biggest in Iceland, and it's huge. And also, he was supposed to have hacked, like these hackers attacked the city council, the prime minister's cabin, like the official government computers within the prime minister's office. And so on. Basically, what's interesting here is that Icelandic government never actually investigated these things. This is not a, like, there is not an open case against Julian Assange in Iceland, and not either Siggi the hacker that has obviously, what do you say, like said that he's responsible for this complicated attacks on Icelandic interest. Nonetheless, the FBI are trying to get the Assange extradited on the testimony of Siggi the hacker. And if you read the article, you can see that this is very questionable in many ways. And even Siggi denies that that Assange had any direct involvement in these behaviors. Not only that, Siggi the hacker was actually convicted in Iceland for stealing from WikiLeaks around $50,000, which is quite the amount in Iceland, and it's just, yeah, it's very interesting. So, Iceland has once again become like the epicenter of these WikiLeaks drama, if you will. And if you want to know everything about it, you can both, of course, see this article in our homepage, as well as Stundin, and it's in English. And it's very well done, very well written, and it's very interesting to see it. So, to the next one. American man got lost around the volcano. Can we see the volcano from here? Or? The volcano should be there. We were just talking about this, me and Art. That there is no smoke over there right now, but there is like a cloud mist. Yeah, mist is probably the best word over it. It's really hot outside, as you can see. And when I'm talking about hot, I'm talking about like 10 to 15 degrees. It's not much more than that, but it's wonderful. Anyway, this man is American and he got lost. He was with his wife and they were walking hiking to the volcano. And they decided to split up. He went to another direction, but the thing is that the weather was not this nice then. It was actually horrible, meaning that the weather was a little bit windy, but mostly you had no visibility. And the thing is, this man, American man, he both forgot water, food, as well as a charged phone, meaning that he got lost. He hiked in the completely wrong direction and ended up basically being lost for over one day. This is nice. So, the search and rescue teams went actually to look for him, and they looked for him for well over 24 hours, and finally found him around 8 to 9 kilometers away from the volcano. His wife, which is a doctor, by the way, she was in an interview at RÚV, the national broadcast of Iceland, yesterday. And it was interesting. She was just telling like how easily this could happen. And the thing is that they didn't do anything wrong. They did a few things wrong, but it's more or less just they were careless about what they were doing. And this is like a good way just to remind everyone that this area is quite dangerous is in so many ways. It's like it's always the hiking. I always say that. So it's basically that, of course, they thought this was much easier than it than it turned out to be. It's not always that very easy for people, especially if you... But they were, again, from Colorado, so they were quite used to the mountains, but perhaps not the terrain, which is can be quite similar if you do not know where you are or have never been hiking in this area before. Also, what he did, which was a clear mistake, is that he tried to find his way back. He was hiking and hiking and hiking, meaning that every time you hike further, it's harder for the search and rescue team to find you. So if you actually find yourself like you have no idea where you are, sit down, wait. There is no other options, actually. But the thing is that, of course, if you sit down and wait, it's hard, both because you have to keep warm, and just to sit and do nothing is always very hard. But I can promise you that the search and rescue teams, they will find you much, much quicker if you just sit down and just wait. Meaning that the perimeter that they are looking at is much smaller than not. They had no idea if you was going north, east, south, or whatever. So But in the end, they found the man, and he was actually, to be honest, like the weather that was here over the weekend, like on Friday, we were not very optimistic that he would survive this, because being in the Icelandic nature, not completely prepared for the Icelandic nature for 24 hours, is a life-threatening thing. So, but thankfully, the man was, he was an experienced hiker, and he actually survived, although he fell on his way. He got like knocked in his head by a stone. Like, what do you call it, just fall down, and his head went into a stone. But thankfully, he was very good shape afterwards. The helicopter came and picked him up, and I have to say, the search and rescue teams are absolutely beautiful. They are brilliant when it comes to these cases, and they found him alive, which is, I have to say, you have to give them that. It's quite something. Just remember, do not just wander out and just take any chances there. If you can't see anything, the chances are that you will get lost. It's not about like being stupid or anything. It's just like if you're in Iceland, in Icelandic nature, it's just different, it's harder, and it can creep up on you, and before you know... What? Did she find a mouse? Cody? Found a moose? I think they found a mouse or something. Anyways, it's just about being prepared and just watch out for everything. And basically think about it before you go. There are always possibility that you will get lost, and think with yourself, how do you want to be equipped when that happened? Like, do you want to have no water? Also, if you had a phone, this would have never been a problem. You just call, they will pinpoint them through that, and so on. You can even find these apps in Iceland. Okay. Cody? You can even find these apps in Iceland where you can download and they have like emergency button and everything. So just keep this in mind. I know, when it comes to tourist attractions, they are almost always very safe, but this is a volcano. This is a little bit different. And so it's not like that you can just go up there without any preparation in any weather and just have a nice time. The better prepared you are, the better this all will be. So, now we're back to the city and to the best news of the year, in my opinion. We have absolutely no domestic restrictions in connection with COVID at all. It's over. Me and Art, we can literally spit on each other and it would be more than fine. As long as Art will be fine with it. I'm always fine with it. But the thing is, on Friday, Minister of Health, she announced that this is literally over. We have vaccinated over 80% of the nation. That means that like they have had at least one shot. In the end of the week, this will be around 90% of the nation. Icelanders are very keen for the vaccination, meaning that we are almost, I mean, there is nothing going on. From 15th to now, 15th of June to now, we had very few cases. The newest thing is actually we had five cases domestically over the weekend, and they were all tourists actually. And these tourists had been vaccinated before, and they were going back to their home country. They didn't feel any symptoms or anything, but there was a mandatory, mandatory check, of course, when you go back home, meaning that they found that they had the virus then. But the vaccination has proven to be so good that if you get the virus and you vaccinate it, you don't spread it as much and such. And we are not that concerned about the Delta virus either. It has been going around, but if you check it out, it's very often that young people getting it, down to like teenagers. But Icelanders are also, we are now vaccinating all youngsters that want to be vaccinated. So we're on the right track. And we cannot only feel it, we can see it in the numbers, and we are officially just back on to normality. I mean, there is no other way to say it. To all of those that think that these vaccinations will kill us or do us any harm, then like, we are a very good proof that this is not happening at all. We are actually just exceeding in a credibly good way. The tourism is open again. Also, there are the restrictions on the borders have changed a little bit. But keep in mind, don't take my word for it. Always go to COVID.is if you want to know how the restrictions are at the time. But I can tell you that if you have been vaccinated and you come to Iceland, you will not be tested anymore. So that moment is gone. But if you have not been, then of course you will be tested and possibly quarantined and so on. So get that shot and you'll be fine, more or less. Our epidemiologist, Þórólfur Guðnason, is very optimistic. He says that we will never have another wave, that's for sure. It's very unlikely. We will have, of course, COVID here and there, but that's because only a portion of the world has been vaccinated. So we still have the virus going strong in some countries that are not doing as good or just as small as we are, meaning that we could have, this will be a problem, of course, and we have not been, we have been instructed, Icelanders, to not being like traveling that much. Basically, like, we can travel, no problem, but the epidemiologists say, I mean, this is not really the time, just do it a year from now. So, a lot of people are actually listening to this, and we are mostly, like myself, just gonna travel domestically, because, I mean, we live in the most beautiful country in the world, in my opinion. This is basically it. We're free. Julian Assange is back on the front pages in Iceland, and thankfully American tourists survived the ordeal of being lost for more than one day and one night in the Icelandic nature, which is astounding, and we were very glad. And Icelanders were quite shocked to see this, and we were waiting and hoping the best, because Icelanders are very empathetic when it comes to people lost in the nature. But this is it. Polly has had a field day. I think she tried to catch a mouse or something. I hope that she failed that, but let's see. We will have, of course, a new newscast on Wednesday, I think, hopefully. But the thing is, now it's print week, meaning that it's possibly that we don't have time to go to the mountain. But we will have both news volcano cast as soon as we can. And we will also have an Icelandic perspective with Bjartmar. And we're going to go a little bit deeper into this thing with Julian Assange and WikiLeaks and these odd connections with Iceland in all of this. Until next time, just be kind. What do you want me to do? Sit. You want me to sit? Sit. Yeah. Stiði. Oh.